32-year-old Army Sergeant First Class returns home to his quarters on base. He staggers to the front door, drunk again. Earlier, he had taken his parents and sister to the airport and told his wife he might be a little late because he was going to stop by and see a friend on the way home. He didn't tell her that his friend was at his favorite bar and that the friend was a she. The night before was Thanksgiving, and the sergeant had again made a fool of himself in front of his wife, kids, and parents. They knew he'd been drinking. What they didn't know is that he had taken several hits of cocaine because he felt the need to be high to enjoy Thanksgiving with his parents and family. Even the talk his father had with him on the way to the airport about his drinking too much and shouldn't do that in front of his kids had no effect on him as he headed to the bar to spend time with his lady friend. When the front door opened, there his wife was with a bag and a box standing next to her, the look of disgust on her face and the sad look of his 7-year-old son told the story. Her words were few but blunt. "We don't want you here anymore. We've had enough of your lies and broken promises. If you don't leave now, I'm calling the MPs to come get you." For the first time in this sergeant's, husband's, father's life, he instinctively knew he wasn't going to talk his way out of it. He grabbed the box and suitcase, put them in his car, and drove off. He would spend the next 3 hours driving around in his car, replaying the words he had heard, and unable to remove the images of his wife and son's face. The denial was lifted. He could no longer make excuses for his own behavior. After 3 hours, he stopped at the liquor store, bought a bottle of Canadian Club whiskey, drove to the Air Inn, got a key to room 16, walked into the room with a bottle, a bag of cocaine, and a .22 caliber pistol, and closed the door. "Hi, I'm Scott Zurhellen, and my wife Barbara and I have been part of the River Valley family for the last 18 years. I'm also a middle school science teacher. Now you might be wondering, what on earth is a middle school science teacher up here talking to you? Or why is one here today talking to you? I was an elder on the board here for almost 6 years. I did learn a lot, believe it or not, while serving on the board. One of the things I had the privilege of observing was how the elders and the pastors here came or went through the decision-making process on how and who would teach different series on the weekend and present the messages. If the series had something to do with, say, sexual purity and the importance of abstinence before marriage, then they'd usually try to get Tyler or Austin to come up and give that message. If the topic was youth and families, then usually Roger Haberman and Dan Hurst would come up and give the message. If the focus was missions, then they'd have Dwayne and Tom Criswell would come up and talk a little bit about that. If the message had anything to do with sainthood, well, we automatically knew Jim Brumback would do that. And if we needed a really, really, really long sermon, then Mark always does those. But whenever the topic turns to brokenness, failed attempts to overcome, or being completely out of God's grace, then there's never any hesitation. It's, let's get Z to do it. He can give that message. So, I'm here because I'm an expert on brokenness, and I've seen and experienced a lot of brokenness through much of my life. And I'm also an authority on pursuing remedies, the wrong remedies, and I'm a case study on what happens when you go after those things to try to fix or numb the pain. You see, I am that Army sergeant, that husband, the father that walked into room 16 of the Air Inn Hotel with every intention of ending the pain and the destruction I caused others and myself. We're in a series called Broken. As we look at our culture and our world, we see brokenness everywhere. Broken children, broken families, broken sexuality, broken government. The list goes on and on. Our brokenness started when sin entered the human race in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve rebelled against God. Since then, our world has been a wreck. But the good news is that Jesus has come to heal and restore all that is broken. And that's our title today, Broken Remedies. What are broken remedies? Well, remedies are cures, answers, solutions that people go after to repair or deal with their broken situation and lives. Most of the remedies are broken remedies because they don't fix what's broken. They only make it worse. So the big idea today, broken remedies only lead to greater brokenness, and God provides the real answers. Thankfully, by God's grace, I have found the real remedy. And for over 30 years, I've been helping others find the same remedy that I have found in Christ. Let me tell you about the remedies that I have pursued. I have tried numerous remedies for my sinning and my sin nature over the years. Some of the remedies I have tried include denial, blame, lying, seeking unhealthy relationships, adultery, rage, pornography, padding expense accounts, stealing, coveting, drinking, drugging, drinking to get off drugs, drugging to get off the booze, divorce, being an accessory to and encouraging an abortion, and this is my short list. I've seen and been personally involved in the damage my sins and remedies have caused to others. All of these can fall into four categories, and maybe you can relate to one of these four categories. First one, substance. Have you ever tried alcohol? Have you ever tried drugs? Have you ever tried marijuana? Have you ever used food to help, to ease the pain, or to feel a little bit better? Pleasure. Have you ever sought after sex, adultery, premarital affairs, pornography as a way to escape? Performance, workaholism, competition, being better than, or materialism. Have you pursued wealth? Have you pursued money? Have you pursued other items that make you feel good? All of which is just fleeting. So the first step in broken remedies is to admit I'm powerless. To understand broken remedies or even the need for remedies, I think you have to begin with why do we need help or healing? I don't think I have to remind you of Paul's words from Romans, and I think Dwayne may have used these last week. We have all sinned and fall short of the glory of God. That would be the simple answer, but then the real question, why do I sin when I know I'm sinning, and why can't I stop sinning on my own, or why try to hide or cover it up? Listen to the way Paul puts it in Romans 7, starting with verse 14. You can follow along if you'd like, or it should be up here on the screen behind me. We know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold as a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. For I know that the good itself does not dwell in me, that is, in my sinful nature. For I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. For I do not do the good I want to do, but the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who do it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in me, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within me. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body that is subject to death? Thanks be to God who delivers me through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature a slave to the law of sin. Wow, what a paradox. And this was 2,000 years ago. In my sinful nature, I am a slave to the law of sin. I love Paul. He's my favorite Bible character. He's the one I identify with the most. Like Paul, I was raised in a religious home, I went through all the church ceremonies and rituals you could in the Catholic Church. I know Paul was Jewish, but I believe Paul went through a lot of the same things as he grew up in his home. I attended Catholic schools. I was instructed daily in the Bible and the rituals of the Catholic faith. I knew who God was, and unlike Paul's upbringing, I knew the story of Jesus. Yet I had never submitted myself to him or truly asked him into my heart. Oh, and by the way, there are several accounts that Paul was also bald. I wasn't raised this way, but I became a self-centered, pleasure-seeking, sin-loving individual. There isn't a commandment I have not broken and tried to cover up or remedy on my own. As a middle school teacher for over 20 years, it has broken my heart to see parents' pursuit of addiction, pleasure, performance, and materialism that have impacted their children and have been sad reminders for me of how my kids suffered and continue to suffer the consequences of their father's immoralities. By the way, some of the remedies I tried offered temporary relief for as long as it altered my mind, but not one of the remedies I tried ever worked or solved my problem. I was unable to overcome even the smallest problem with my attempts. You see, in my sinful nature, I'm a slave to the remedies that allow me to keep on sinning. Paul puts it this way in Romans 1, 21 through 25. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of immortal God for images made to look like a mortal human being and birds and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over to the sinful desires of their hearts, to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshiped and served created things rather than the Creator. We all rely on something. What is it that you have put your faith in? Is it something that can be killed, stolen, or destroyed, as Jesus talks about in John 10:10? Or is it someone eternal? Satan wants to take away our joy, peace, and contentment. He wants to take away our reliance on God. He wants us to experience the fleeting euphoria that comes with sin. He wants us to become reliant on our own abilities, to self-medicate, to overcome, and will give us plenty of opportunities to suffer the consequences of our choices to rely on something else rather than God. Paul, however, discovered the secret to overcoming in the province of Asia. So step two, pursue the real remedies. So listen carefully to Paul's account from 2 Corinthians 1, verses 8 through 10. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure. So we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death. Here's the key. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him, we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us. Many, many times, as I drove around for 3 hours, I asked, why? Why has it come to this? The answer I came up with was, it's all about me. I did this. I caused this. The destruction that's happening in front of my eyes was all of my doing. And much like Paul felt when he was in Asia, I was in deep, deep despair. I saw no way out. That's why I stopped, bought a bottle of whiskey, took what I had left of the cocaine and a 22 caliber pistol into her room with me. I was in such deep despair. There was no hope in me whatsoever. And because of these words in 2 Corinthians, I understand why. Because I couldn't let God, I couldn't let anyone in to my life until I reached that place of complete and utter brokenness. And I've had the opportunity the last 30 years to use that kind of brokenness to work with other broken men that have reached that point in their life. It's not until I got to that point that I realized that I need Jesus. John 16:33 says this, "In this world you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart, I have overcome the world." We often talk about the promises of God, but we fail to mention or dwell on this one. Jesus didn't say we might have trials. He promises that we will. Some by our own making, or some by others or situations, but we all are going to have trials. Not might, will. Let me be the first to say over 95% of my trials were of my own making and my dependence on something not eternal. Now I understand why you need water up here. We live in a world dominated by the enemy. Again, John 10:10, he's like a lion, wandering, waiting to pounce. So remember this, being in turmoil, difficulty, persecution, and hardship are not essential indicators of being out of God's will. It's an indication of how much we need God. And if you're like me, you really have to go through the ringer. And you have to take a lot of people with you to get to a place where you finally understand this, to where I finally understood this. Acts 3:19 says, "Repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out, that times of refreshing may come from the Lord." In Romans 5:3-5, "Not only so, but we glorify in our sufferings because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." I could not do this on my own. And I tried. I did not want to hurt people. I had already spent 13 years in the Army, and I had seen man's inhumanity to man, and I'd been involved in man's inhumanity to man, and I didn't want to hurt nobody. And I thought everything that I did, the only person I was hurting was me. I just didn't care. I got to a place where I didn't care anymore. And I pray this with the men that I work with a lot of times, that they're at that point of total, utter despair. Because without it, I was never ready. I had an extremely high threshold for pain. Now being over 60, I don't have much of a threshold for pain anymore. Everything hurts. Like I said, I could not do it on my own. I need family. I need Jesus' family. And thank God he put the right people in my life at just the right time. As I said before, my parents didn't raise me to be a self-centered, pleasure-seeking, sin-loving individual. The remedies that I described earlier were my attempts to overcome consequences of my destructive behavior. I would not have been ready to hear the message and the cure I truly needed until I became as willing as only the dying can be. I wanted to die. I did not want to go on. Again, I could not remove the images of my wife's face or my son's face at that time. I never turned to anyone for help or advice. When Paul mentioned the sufferings he endured in Asia, he was not alone. Silas and others were with him. He delivered us. He delivered them. And he delivered me. I would not have found the remedy that works if not for the people that God put in my life. Because see, in that room, in that motel room, I didn't have a God awakening. I didn't get the zap. I didn't get the burning bush. It wasn't all of a sudden I jumped up for joy and I said, that's what I need. I just need God. That's not what happened. I walked out completely broken, completely broken. I couldn't even take my life. And I finally realized I needed help. I would not be on this path today if not for the men and the wife that God placed in my life at just the right time. Ecclesiastes 4, 9 through 12 says this, two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If either of them falls down, one can help the other up. But pity anyone who falls and has no one to help them up. Also, if two lie down together, they will keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. And a cord of three strands is not quickly broken. I cannot recover, and I can't do life on my own. I need others. James 5:16, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And I've had a lot of prayer just tonight before I got up here. We are called to die to ourselves and to our desires. This is where the great chasm exists to those who will overcome and those who will achieve victory. This world is very tantalizing, and it's difficult to let go. You know, 19-year-old Scott would love to be in Oregon right now with all the laws that have been passed. You see, this would have been 19-year-old Scott's heaven, to be able to go out and do the things that you can do here. I'd love it. I would love it. The Bible is full of sinners who couldn't let go of this world, but a few did. Some that did struggled their entire lives. David, King Solomon. The road is narrow, but the vast majority of people in this world struggle and cannot let go. Me being here today, alive and being used for good, is not the end of my story. These things happened to me over 30 years ago, and yet today I still suffer the consequences of my actions from 30 years ago. My ex-wife will not forgive me. She still is hurt and deeply wounded by my actions, by my false promises, by the lies, by my denial. My daughter has not talked to me in over 20 years because of the hurt and the anguish that I caused her mom. In 2 months, she will be married for the third time in 12 years. She has two children. I have two grandchildren I've never met. And she drinks like her father drank. These things keep me broken. And these things keep me humbled. 2 Corinthians 12, Paul talks about asking God to remove a thorn, remove the pain that he feels. I do the same thing daily as I lift my daughter up and I lift my ex-wife up. And as hard as it is for me, I still rejoice in my brokenness, because I know, as big an ego as I have, as big a self-reliance as I have, I need that brokenness in my life to keep me humble, to keep me going to the one supernatural person that can help me. And as hard as it is, and as hard as it is for me to watch, I know God's involved, and I know he's got it, and I know he's going to take care of it, whether I see it happen in my lifetime or not. That's the kind of trust, and that's the kind of faith that I have today. And I never had that before, ever. So where do we go from here? Where are you today? What are you struggling with? What are you struggling with trying to find a remedy for? Have you given up? Have you lost hope in all things of this world? Have you endured all that you can? Are you as willing as only the desperate can be? Because what I'm going to tell you is the same thing that I've told other men that I've been around. If you're not at that place, then don't try to control it. Don't try to regulate it. Don't try to overcome it. Enjoy it. Get your fill. Get all you can. Let it take you to a place where you're totally and utterly broken, where you reach that point of despair, where you know there's no other way. There's nothing else you can do. So if you're ready, what are some of the next steps? Well, we have life groups here at River Valley. You probably haven't heard much about life groups, but we have life groups here at River Valley. And if you're a member of a life group, great. If you're not, I would encourage you to at least check them out. But sharing in a life group, life group is a great place to meet other men or meet other women and hear their stories and find people that you can trust, that you can share with. I have a mentor today in my life that I talk to, that I see weekly. I'm in a life group. My wife and I sponsor a life group at our home. And I love meeting with those men in my life group. It's important to find somebody. It's important to find that one person that you can share your story with. Celebrate Recovery. You probably haven't heard us talk much about that lately, but Celebrate Recovery is something that I've been involved with ever since it started here in Grants Pass 14 years ago. If you're struggling, and it doesn't have to be an addiction, but if you're struggling, that's a great place. There are a lot of people in Celebrate Recovery that have overcome issues, not just addictions, not just drugs and alcohol, but other issues. And it's a great place to start. It's a great place to at least check out and see and listen to some of the testimonies there. And then we offer here at River Valley, but you can also find it outside, counseling and support, Christian counseling. We have several that come to our church. The only thing I'm going to tell you from my own experience is you can't do it alone. I can't do it alone. You can't do it alone. Yes, we all need Jesus. But it's important to have someone else in our life that we trust, that we can share with, and that they know the Lord. It's always important to have somebody that's ahead of us, that's been through the ringer, that can do that. They say if you want something that is broken to be put back together correctly, then go to the one who created it. We need to take our brokenness to the Creator. He's waiting to purify us, to put us back together, and to use us for His glory. So why am I here today? I make God look really good. I really do. Oh, and I make my wife look like a saint. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here. I would also encourage you at the end, I'll be here and we'll have some members of the prayer team here. If you would like to talk, come up for prayer, please do that. And I'm available afterwards. Love to sit down and talk with you and share stories. Thank you.